My father's fathers were seafaring men. His grandfathers and their grandfathers set sail from the icy ports of Norway. The blood of Vikings ran through their veins. Tobias Torsen, great-grandfather on George's grandmother's side, was captain of his own ship. And another prominent ancestor, Theodore Strom, lay in state in the great cathedral in Trondheim, Norway, when he died. So, it is understandable that at age 16, our father and grandfather, George Chester Dahl, gave his future to the sea when he joined the U.S. Navy as a seaman. He was actually too young to serve, but instead went to sea as a merchant marine when he was discharged from the Navy 2 years later. There was a love-hate relationship with the sea all his life. It was in his blood, and it pulled him back, but the lonely months and hours away from loved ones and family were never easy.
I was sailing 365 days a year, and for 2 weeks off, then go back for another 365.
His work was below decks in the engine rooms, powering the huge merchant ships back and forth from New York to South America, and later from San Francisco to Asia.
Kind of hard to talk about. There's nothing happens out there, really. I mean, you're on the ship 24 hours a day. Well, I wore two hats. I was in charge of the engine room. And another hat where I was responsible for any and all repairs on the ship. Mm-hmm. I had a budget of about $3 million a year to cover the ship and hopefully no major damages like collisions or anything like that. I did go through three fires on tankers. And the tankers were destroyed. About half the crew was killed on those, on each one of them, I guess.
I must go down to the sea again, to the lonely sea and the sky. And all I need is a tall ship and a star to steer her by. George was born in Lewiston, Maine, the son of Vera Mildred West and Edward Torsen Dahl.
I was born in Maine, and I guess about 2 weeks later, we moved from there to Southern California. My only remembrances from that were my dad get up really early in the morning and going someplace for a half an hour, 45 minutes. And when he got back, we always had oatmeal. And I found out later that he was going out, and this was in the depth of the Depression, he was going out and stealing a bottle of milk off of somebody's back porch that had half a dozen bottles. And oatmeal was the cheapest food you could buy, so.
Edward was a young engineer, graduated from MIT with high honors. He founded Hamel Dahl Corporation, which produced parts for the first atomic submarines and other automatic controls for naval destroyers.
Oh, I remember taking a ride in my dad's car. The car only cost $400 or $500, so if you went after a used car, maybe you'd get a pretty good one for $25. We went to this hospital, and it was supposed to be my mother up there. I'm not sure. But there was a woman up there, and I'd wave from the car, and in the meantime, my dad would be gone for an hour or something like that. And they had this long, sloping driveway. And I managed to get the emergency brake off, and here we go. I don't know, I guess I might have went a couple of miles before the sucker found something to hit and stop. And the old man, he always laughed. He said it took me a half an hour to find him.
Vera was a beautiful young divorcee when Edward met her. They married and moved to Southern California, where she died when her son George was merely 5 years old. George said he always felt his mother looking out for him and had a deep hunger to know more about her. He would often ask himself, what would my mother think? Would she approve or not? After her death, Edward married twice more, and George was delighted to have a baby sister, a blonde, petite, blue-eyed little girl with a face like an angel. He always spoke of his sister Eve Elise with tenderness and love. At about 8 years old, George was sent to a boarding school called the Worcester School, after which he went to the Farragut Academy, named for Lord Admiral William Farragut of Damn the Torpedoes fame.
I played baseball a little bit in grammar school, but that's as far as I got in school was grammar school. I didn't get any high school. Whatever I've gotten in education has been correspondence schools. I took, and they didn't have anything like a GED or anything like that in those days. I just bought courses.
George was named for his grandfather, George Bjarne Dahl, who was born in Norway and was a seaman all his life.
Well, Grandpa started out as a coal passer years and years and years ago. And then he went through, became an engineer, and then he got involved with the transition from coal to oil on ships. He became a chief engineer and later on a port engineer, which allowed him to go ashore and stay ashore. And he came ashore in America when there was a saying that says, let George do it. So he just adopted George. His real name was Bjarne. Bjarne, so.
Elise Torsendahl, his grandmother, was affectionately known as Nenny. These beloved grandparents, along with his Aunt Thelma and Uncle Marshall Bell, lived in the beautiful mountains of upstate New York in the small hamlet of Durham. He had good memories there with these loving relatives and his father's brother, also named George, and his sons, Johnny and Georgie. There were then four Georges in the family, which is why Aunt Thelma gave him the nickname of Sonny, which she used all his life. At 14 years of age, George ran away.
Well, I was just tired of all the shenanigans in the house and whatnot, and I decided to leave, so I did.
He found a job parking cars in a car lot down the street from the theater.
I slept in a car that night because I got a job in a parking lot, parking cars in a parking lot. I had to carry a pillow with me. I was so small. I was making big money. I was making $100 a week, over $100 a week, way back then. The lot was supposed to close at midnight, and you took all the keys and you carried them down to what they call the master lot, right in the heart of the city. And anybody that came after midnight, they had to walk the 5 blocks down there and 5 blocks back to get their key. So this one evening, it occurred to me that I should sit there and at midnight and wait until these people came out of the theater, the movies, or whatever, and I'd hand them their keys in one hand and my palm out in the other one. And I was making big tips.
At 14 years of age, George ran away and lived on his own in a boarding house where a kind German woman provided one meal a day.
You know, in those days, there weren't hotels and motels and huge apartment houses and whatnot like there are now, you know, and I got this apartment converted out of a private home. Heck, I had my own private entrance and a private bath, and I think it was like $12 or $14 a month. But I had old sweetheart, grandmotherly type landlady, and she took it upon herself to. She always washed my socks, and I always had donuts when I woke up in the morning. But in those days, any car would stop and pick up a kid, and or a grown up. Yeah, it wasn't like today. Today everybody's scared to death of picking somebody up. And yeah, that was a kid's only mode of transportation. They get that big thumb out there in the air. And during the Depression, during the war, if somebody goofed up really badly and they were in court, the judges had two or three things they could do. They could sentence you to jail, and they could make you go in the army, or they could make you go in the merchant marine. When I went in the merchant marine, it was full of rough hombres, most of them. They were not to be played with. Yeah, it was a rough and tumble school. Rough and tumble.
At age 24, George's life changed. He met a beautiful, long-haired, long-legged Southern belle by the name of Eileen Wall.
I met your mother in Jacksonville, Florida, in a bar. The only bar in Jacksonville at the time where, as a merchant seaman, I could go. Long-legged, good-looking blonde. had a girlfriend named Helen. They just got off of work and they just were down there having a drink, and I was with another guy, and so. Oh, she must have been 22, because she's 2 years younger than I am, so. She had on a black and white dress with diagonals running from shoulder to the center. Yeah, that's what she should have been wearing. She looked good in it.
It was practically love at first sight. She came complete with country cooking, country singing, jitterbug dancing, a great big family, and a ragtag muffin 4-year-old daughter named Marcia Ann. Could you ask for anything more?
I think I went back to sea. I don't think we got married that time. I think we went back to sea. I know I did. I know I did. Because I got fired off the ship in New Orleans, and I went, where am I going to go now, and what am I going to do? And I thought, Jacksonville. Yeah, we got married. Dumb kids. I didn't have a job, and you couldn't get a job in those days. That's when they first came up with the word recession. They didn't dare use the word depression, because we had just come out of one. Second World War brought us out of the depression. I met my daughter. She came crawling out from under the house. Dirty, dirty, dirty. She got within about 10 feet of me, I guess, and stared. Ran inside yelling for Granny. I guess about 2 weeks later, yeah, my day was made. She came busting out of the door and yelling, Daddy, Daddy! And I went, oh, I'm a daddy. And everybody was pushing to have you kiss me and all this jazz and sit in my lap. And I kept telling her to shut up. Let her do her thing, you know, when she feels like it.
The marriage lasted for 13 years, but the friendship lasted their whole life long. Eileen and George both knew that the seagoing profession was hard on a marriage, and it was eventually too hard for them to live with. But despite the differences of two independent spirits, they have remained friends.
They have some good times. It's funny, doesn't seem to make much difference whether you got a bunch of money in your pocket or very, very little in your pocket. You manage to make some good times. You didn't have all the entertainment facilities that you have today, you know, TV and, hell, I can remember when an awful lot of households didn't even have a radio. I know when I was a kid, I made my own with my dad's help, an old Crystal radio. I got one station. But yeah, no TV. Movies were a big thing, so you could save up. Well, a quarter to get you a movie and a milkshake afterwards.
Eventually, George married Wanda in Baltimore, Maryland in 1981. Much like Eileen, Wanda brought a daughter to the marriage. Diana, or Dee Dee, was also adopted by George. They settled in Washington, first in the Seattle area as George was shipping out, then in Newport, just outside Spokane, on 20 beautiful wooded acres near Diamond Lake. Although George and Wanda divorced in 1997, he and Dee Dee have maintained a warm relationship and talked frequently right up until his death. She is married now and living in Connecticut with her family. His earliest pictures have dogs. You might call him the dog whisperer. He was so good with them. Always a nature lover, he delighted in the observation of birds, deer, dogs, squirrels, and any form of wildlife. The last few months of his life he spent being entertained by the birds and deer and fox outside his window at Marcia and Jean's home. Some of the happiest years of George's life were spent riding his Honda Goldwing with the Blue Knights Motorcycle Club.
The first one was a what you call a 500. That was a small one, wasn't a wing. So then I bought that black and silver Goldwing. I think that's the one. The one you and I came, and we went from my house down here or the other way?
Other way, from here up.
Oh, that was a pretty fine bike. I guess I had it 4 or 5 years or something, then I bought that last one. 1500, yeah, that was a going machine. There for 5 or 6 years, I did about 12,000 miles a year, including what they call a four corner run, which everybody kind of dreams of making, and that's from like Washington to New Hampshire, down to Key West, to Southern California, and back to Washington.
Some of the happiest years of George's life were spent enjoying his friends at the Eagles Club and around town, and spending lots of quiet moments on his property in Newport, Washington, with his best friend, Woof. During many long days, Woof was his most loyal companion. We hope he finds her again on the other side of the veil, waiting and wagging as usual. George was a loyal friend, generous, fun, interested, and interesting. He learned the carpentry trade in California, where he worked as a carpenter and was a capable builder. He earned his pilot's license in 1964 in California and enjoyed flying small planes.
I was on this hospital ship in 1960, and I sat between the chief engineer, I was the second assistant engineer, I sat between the chief engineer and the chief mate, and they were both flyers. Chief engineer had been a fighter pilot in the Navy in the Second World War, and the mate, he was just a private pilot. And after listening to them for a year, I mean, I was a flyer. The second day after I came ashore, I went down and bought an airplane for $1,000. And then that chief engineer there, he flew with me about 3 or 4 hours, and then I soloed. Because I did, I knew how to fly. Listening to those two knuckleheads, you know, for a whole year, felt kind of boring after a while, really. But that was a great thing to do, probably the greatest thing to do that I ever did.
You had a ball?
Oh, yeah, and you're up there all by yourself, and look at all those people down there. And nah, 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 nah. If I hadn't flown in 90 days, I always took a pilot up with me, an instructor, just to make sure I didn't have any bad habits or something. Maybe I can get that kid I know named Joe to go down and go flying with me one day here. Go down and rent an airplane for a couple of hours and poop around.
The dawn is breaking.
Matter of fact, I remember flying in Singapore. They had a grass strip down there. And the British, their airports are for private planes like that. They could be any field. They didn't go after hard surfaced or, well, they had bars in there. They didn't care if you drank or didn't drink. They had bars in there. But I went in there one night, ship came in port, and I went running over there one afternoon. It was a pretty good crosswind, and I ran into the plane, and everybody's looking at me like I've got rocks in the head, and I went out there and took off and pooped around a little bit and came back and landed. Then there were a couple of guys there, how about giving us some lessons in crosswind landing, you know? And so I got a bunch of free flying there after that.
Out of the doubt that fills my mind, but somehow find you and I collide.
But that was a great thing to do, probably the greatest thing to do that I ever did. Oh yeah, and you're up there all by yourself, and look at all those people down there, and nah, 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 nah.
You make a first impression, but I've found I'm scared to know I'm always on your mind. Even the best.
Yeah, the one time I broke that rule of not flying until I've flown with an instructor. I hadn't flown in about 9 months, and I walked into the Flying 10 Club there at San Carlos Airport. And Pete was in there, and he was kind of upset he couldn't make the plane stall the way the instructors wanted you to make a plane stall, which means stop flying. So I said, well, the heck, that's the easiest thing in the world, Pete. And, is your plane available? Let's go up. and I said it without thinking. I hadn't been around or anything like that. And so we went up, and I started trying to make him do a stall, and finally I hit him in the arm and said, pull on the stick, pull it back in your gut, pull hard, you know. And we did, and that plane, that it went over the top, as they call it, and went into a spin. Well, it's, I mean, you're looking right straight down at the ground, you know. And these planes today, they're so forgiving. You just, if you take your hands and feet off everything, as long as you have altitude, they'll straighten themselves out. So it wasn't really a big deal, but I can hear him. The words was coming out of his mouth over there. Can't repeat them. Yeah, I miss that bike. Well, I miss flying. Flying became expensive. Just pure expensive. But my original plane, I paid $1,000 for. I sold it for $1,000 4 or 5 years later. But that was a great thing to do. Probably the greatest thing to do that I ever did.
In 2004, George was diagnosed with cancer, which quickly spread from lungs to bone and then throughout his body. The last few months of his life were spent living with his daughter and son-in-law, Marcia and Jean Newman, in Sandy, Utah. He loved his grandchildren. They often gathered around him for support, and after his retirement, he rarely missed a wedding or a graduation. On August 23, 2005, we gave an 80th birthday party for him, to which his dear sister Eve and husband Chuck came, as well as Paul and Colleen Landy from California, special friends for 45 years. Many of the grandchildren came to express their devotion. To them, he was always special and very beloved. George never forgot his dear friends from Newport. He was so very grateful when they called or sent notes. He would want special mention of Les and Jerry Wagner, Jim and Sue McDonald, and Kathy Johnson. They were like family to him.
People are the same all over the world, the same as we are, got the same problems, and just as bigoted or as mean or as kind or as we are.
Yeah. Sunset, an evening star, and one clear call for me. And may there be no moaning of the bar when I put out to sea, but such a tide as moving seems asleep, too full for sound or foam, when that which drew from out the boundless deep turns again home. Twilight, an evening bell, and after that, the dark. And may there be no sadness of farewell when I embark, for though from out our bourne of time and place the flood may bear me far, I hope to see my pilot face to face when I have crossed the bar. George C. Dahl turned again home on March 25, 2006 at 1:15 a.m., succumbing to his disease and passing away with Marcia and Jean at his bedside. They counted a privilege to have had him in their home these last few months of his life, sharing with him their time, their love, and their faith in God, and a sweet life hereafter. He salutes you all and hopes to be remembered from time to time with fondness from those he knew and loved.